Please.
Howdy.
Howdy.
I'm Bowen Lofton, interim president of Texas A&M University. And on behalf of the entire Aggie family, I welcome you to our campus today. We come together to mark the passing of Dr. Norman Borlaug and to remember his profound and lasting contributions that have improved the lives of millions of people around the world. Dr. Borlaug once said that we can't build a peaceful world on empty stomachs and human misery. Through his humanitarian work over many decades, Dr. Borlaug accomplished more than any other human being has ever accomplished to build a peaceful world. Despite his great achievements, Dr. Borlaug was a man of great humility and grace. As many of you know, he continued late in his life to teach classes and mentor students. He will be greatly missed by all of us here at Texas A&M. But his legacy will live on, and live on forever here and elsewhere, through the hearts and minds he touched during his life. Through our land-grant mission of improving lives through teaching, research, and engagement, and through the Norman Borlaug Institute for International Agriculture, we are honored to have this association with this great and noble human being. Thank you for being here today to remember Dr. Borlaug.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather today to remember your servant, Norman. We thank you for his remarkable life and for the great good works you did through him. Receive our brother into the arms of your mercy. Acknowledge him as a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Gracious God, hear the prayers of hungry and poor people throughout the world. Give them bountiful crops and hope for the future. And use us for your purposes in the world. Amen. The first scripture reading is from Isaiah. The desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose, and the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. The second Bible lesson is from Matthew 25. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, "Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I say you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brethren, you did it to me." And finally, a lesson from St. Paul's letter to the Romans. "For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord."
Oh,
feel very privileged to have been invited to speak at this memorial where so many of us have gathered to celebrate the life and work of Norman Borlaug, who has been aptly referred to by the Nobel Peace Prize Committee as the greatest hunger fighter of our time. I've had the privilege of knowing Dr. Borlaug and working with him for nearly 50 years. I first heard him in 1953 outline an innovative strategy for combating wheat rust at Madison in the University of Wisconsin. From 1963 onwards, he visited India in March every year to see the wheat crop. During his extensive travels by road, he used to stop frequently, talk to the farmers, and examine the state of the health of the crop. Plants and farmers became his lifelong friends and companions, and eliminating the wheat rust menace became his unrelenting mission until his last day. Dr. Borlaug started his research career in agriculture in Mexico at a time when the world was passing through a serious food crisis. During 1942-43, nearly 2 million people died of hunger during the Great Bengal Famine. China also experienced widespread and severe famine during the 1950s. Famines were frequent in Ethiopia, the Sahelian region of Africa, and many other parts of the developing world. It was in this background that Borlaug decided to look for a permanent solution to recurrent famines by harnessing science to increase the productivity, profitability, and sustainability of small farms. The work he did in Mexico during the 1950s in breeding semi-dwarf, photo-insensitive, rust-resistant wheat varieties and its extension to India, Pakistan, and other countries during the 1960s brought about a total transformation in the atmosphere regarding the possibility of achieving a balance between human numbers and the human capacity to produce food. Developing nations gained in self-confidence in their agricultural capability. He disproved the prophets of doom like Paul and William Paddock, Paul and Ann Ehrlich, and Paul and William Paddock even advocated the application of the triage principle in the selection of countries which should or should not be saved from starvation through American assistance. The introduction of semi-dwarf varieties of wheat in India in the early 1960s helped not only to improve wheat production, but also led to the union of brain and brawn in rural areas. The enthusiasm generated by the new technology can be glimpsed in the following extract from an article I had written in the Illustrated Weekly of India early in 1969, and I quote, "Brimming with enthusiasm, hardworking, skilled and determined, the Punjab farmer has been the backbone of the revolution. Revolutions are usually associated with the young, but in this revolution, age has been no obstacle to participation. Farmers, young and old, educated and uneducated, have easily taken to the new agronomy. It has been heartwarming to see young college graduates, retired officers, ex-army men, illiterate peasants, and small farmers all queuing up to get the new seeds. At least in the Punjab, the divorce between intellect and labor, which has been the bane of our agriculture, is vanishing thanks to the new technology which Borlaug helped introduce. The five principles Borlaug adopted in his life, to quote his own words, were give your best, believe you can succeed, face adversity squarely, be confident you will find the answers when problems arise, then go out and win some bouts. These principles have shaped the attitude and action of thousands of young farm scientists whom he has stimulated over the last 60 years across the world. He applied these principles in the field of science and agricultural development, but I guess he developed them much earlier in the field of wrestling, judging from his induction into the Iowa Wrestling Hall of Fame in 2004. Having made a significant contribution to shaping the agricultural destiny of many countries in Asia and Latin America, Borlaug turned his attention to Africa in the 80s. With support from President Jimmy Carter, the late Yohei Sasakawa, Mr. Yohei Sasakawa, and the Nippon Foundation, he organized the Sasakawa Global 2000 program. Numerous small-scale farmers were helped to double and triple the yield of maize, rice, sorghum, millet, wheat, cassava, and grain legumes. Unfortunately, such spectacular results in demonstration plots did not lead to significant production gains at the national level due to lack of infrastructure, such as irrigation, roads, seed production, and above all, an assured and remunerative marketing system. This made him exclaim, and I quote, "Africa has the potential for a green revolution, but you cannot eat potential. The blend of professional skill, political action, and farmers' enthusiasm needed to ignite another green revolution, as in India, was lacking in Africa at that time. But thanks to the program, which has been led by Dr. Borlaug, the situation is fast changing." Concerned with the lack of adequate recognition for the contributions of farm and food scientists, he had the World Food Prize established in 1986, which he hoped would come to be regarded as the Nobel Prize for Food and Agriculture. My research center in Chennai in India is the child of the first World Food Prize I received in 1987. Throughout his professional career, Borlaug spent time in training young scholars and researchers. This led him to promote the World Food Prize Youth Institute and its program to help high school students in Iowa work in other countries in order to widen their understanding of the human condition. This usually became a life-changing experience for them. When Mahatma Gandhi died in January 1948 in India, the then Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, said, and I quote, "The light has gone out of our life, but the light that shone in this country was no ordinary light. 1,000 years later, that light will be seen in this country. The world will see it, and it will give solace to numerous hearts. For that light represented the living, eternal truth, reminding us of the right path, drawing us away from error, taking humankind to freedom from hunger and deprivation." Quotation ends. The same can be said of Norman Borlaug, his repeated message that there was no time to relax until hunger became history will be heard as long as a single person is denied opportunity for a healthy and productive life because of malnutrition. Norman Borlaug was a remarkable man who was supported by a remarkable family. Wife Margaret, son William, daughter Jenny, and lovely grandchildren and great-grandchildren. His wife Margaret, who died in 2007, to my mind, is the unsung heroine of the Green Revolution. Without her unwavering support, Borlaug might not have accomplished nearly so much in his long and demanding career. In the Indian spiritual text, Bhagavad Gita, sometimes referred to as the Bible of Hinduism, there's a saying that the divine manifests itself in various forms whenever there's acute suffering or injustice on earth. I feel it would be appropriate to consider Borlaug as one such messenger who came to the rescue of those struggling for the daily bread. I am saying this because Borlaug was not only a great scientist, but also a humanist full of compassion and love for fellow human beings, irrespective of race, religion, color, or political belief. This is clear from his last spoken words on the night of Saturday, 12th September 2009. Earlier in the day, a scientist had shown him a nitrogen tracer developed by measuring soil fertility. His last spoken words were, I quote, "Take the tracer to the farmer." This lifelong dedication to taking scientific innovation to farmers without delay set Borlaug apart from most other farm scientists carrying out equally important research. I was privileged to be present when he was awarded the Congressional Gold Medal in 2007. On that occasion, he pointed out that between the years 1960 and 2000, the proportion of the world's people who felt hunger during some portion of the year had fallen from 60% to 14%. The latter figure, he went on, still translates into 850 million women, men, and children, now it is over a billion, who lack sufficient calories and protein to grow strong and healthy bodies. He added, the battle to ensure food security for hundreds of millions of miserably poor people is far from won. This is the unfinished task that Norman Borlaug leaves to scientists, political leaders, and every one of us worldwide. It will be appropriate for the Norman Borlaug Institute for International Agriculture to become the flagship of the movement for a world without hunger. Before I conclude, I have the privilege of announcing that the Government of India, in recognition of Dr. Borlaug's monumental contributions to food security and rural prosperity in India as well as worldwide, the government has decided to institute a Norman Borlaug Distinguished Chair at the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi, with which he had association for more than 50 years.
Good morning to all. I must say that I am a little bit hesitant to speak today, for I realize that there are many people, perhaps many in this auditorium, far more qualified to speak about the life and times of Dr. Norman Borlaug than I am. I'm not a family member, I wasn't a close personal friend, nor did I have the opportunity to be a colleague. Perhaps it's because I was a governor of Iowa, the place of his birth, but also the place where his heart always remained. Perhaps it was because I'm the Secretary of Agriculture today. Dr. Borlaug's work in agriculture is obviously known worldwide. What may not be known is that one of his first jobs was at USDA and the Forest Service when he happened to be employed during college. But I believe that I'm here today to focus on a part of his life that often is not discussed in great detail. For it's my view that his experiences up to the age of 16 shaped his life to a point where his life's work was predictable. In reality, he really had no choice but to be the man that he was, the scientist, the teacher, the saver of lives, and for that he will always be rightly recognized and rewarded. Born in 1914, during a period of time when food, not just in the world, but in the United States, was scarce, so that at an early age he understood subsistence farming, its risks and its perils. That may be a reason why he was so successful in relating to most of the world's farmers, who still today are involved in subsistence farming. Born and raised at a time when one out of every 10 children died before they reached the age of one, he understood mortality and the urgency of providing help to those who are sick and in need, and that delay in providing that help can often cost lives. Rescued by a cousin during a walk when he was young from school, caught in a blizzard, her helping hand and stern words of encouragement allowed him to survive and to keep on going. He understood that day, in a very real way, the power of a helping hand that can save lives. Counseled by his beloved grandfather to, quote, fill your head now so you can fill your belly later, end quote, he was encouraged to seek knowledge and to appreciate the power it has to transform lives. A lesson he took to farmers all over the world, as he advocated for the power of technology to save lives and to change them to avoid hunger and malnutrition. Taught in a one-room schoolhouse where students were teachers and teachers were students, he learned that every student is at the same time a teacher and a student, a lesson he no doubt imparted to those who he taught in classrooms and in farm fields throughout the world. Watching his father take advantage of technology in the form of fertilizer and new seeds and complex farm equipment, he saw its power to change subsistence to surplus, a notion he perpetuated with his work. A plaque given to him by his teacher, the very same cousin who saved his life, read, "Advance in learning as you advance in life. Good instruction is better than riches. Kindness is the noblest weapon." I believe that plaque spurred Norman Borlaug to always continue to learn. It encouraged him to attend high school. That gave him the opportunity to attend college. It directed his life in a profound way. It may also have stirred him to establish the Borlaug internships within the World Food Prize Foundation, touching the lives of high school students every single year. His high school years exposed him to athletics and opened those doors to college. It was his high school coach who provided him the direction of his life. He was told to give his best, to believe he can succeed, to face adversity squarely, and be confident that he could find the answers to problems that arise. He followed that prescription in feeding the hungry and empowering farmers to do so as well. And he understood that he needed to persist despite the inevitable setbacks that science often involves. Norman Borlaug, by any measure, gave his best and expects us to do the same. By any measure, he believed he could succeed, but he also believed we could succeed. He was willing to face adversity squarely, and so must we, with 600,000 children in this country hungry today and 1 billion people worldwide. He was confident in his ability to find answers to persistent problems. But more importantly, he was confident in our capacity and ability to find those very same answers. Despite his great work, and despite the millions of lives he saved, it is my firm belief that his best work is yet to come. He has instilled in young people a love of science. He has instilled in farmers a belief in science. And I believe, working together, we will realize his dream of a world without hunger.
Save from wrath and make me pure. a quarter century has elapsed. Dr. Borlaug, since you became involved in Africa's agricultural development, my father and I approached you when you were already 70. We wanted to do something to help alleviate the hunger of starving Africans, and we sought your help. We knew it was a lot to ask, but you willingly agreed. Since then, no matter how busy you were, you made African farmers and their children your priority. Ginny, Bill, and other members of the family, your father loved all of you dearly, and he cared deeply for African farmers. Even when he was on the brink of pneumonia in Malawi, even when he was stricken by cancer, he was always more concerned for the well-being of African farmers than he was for himself. Remarkably, he never complained, however tough the predicament. He was the kind of person who was motivated by meeting difficult challenges head on. He spent as much time as possible in the field, kindly and painstakingly passing on his knowledge to African farmers. At the same time, he took a strict approach to training country directors. Something I shall never forget is the look of pure happiness on his face as he watched farmers dance for joy at an annual harvest festival. Dr. Borlaug often said, "Africa's children mustn't go to sleep hungry." He kept that thought in mind, and what he achieved went beyond satisfying their hunger. Norman, you cultivated a dream that would empower the farmers. You planted the seeds of hope. You water them with enthusiasm. You gave them sunshine. You inspired with your passion. You harvested confidence in the hearts of African farmers. You never gave up. I am now 17 years old, about the age you were when you began working with Africa. I pray to you this, to spend the rest of my days pursuing your dream of a green revolution for Africa. I will work together with the leaders, students, researchers and farmers who embody the Borlaug spirit. I will never give up. Dr. Borlaug, Norman, may you rest in eternal peace.
Howdy. Texas A&M held a special place in Norman Borlaug's heart. I invited him to speak at commencement in December 2003, and he opened his remarks with this statement. I first came to Aggieland the spring semester of 1984 as a visiting professor for what I imagined would be one semester per year for 3 or 4 years. I apparently became infected with the Howdy virus. For here I am, nearly 20 years later, engaged in teaching about international agriculture and food problems, converted to and enjoying the friendly, stimulating spirit of Howdy Land. This is the season in College Station that Norm would be here for students, his seminars, and football. He never missed a game when he was in town. One incredibly hot September game day in 2005, Norm drove up to the parking lot where he had a reserved space. The contract parking police told him the lot was full and he couldn't park there. And they directed Norm to a lot about half a mile away, on Agronomy Road, I think. And the 91-year-old Nobel Prize recipient hiked to the stadium in the blistering heat. One of Norm's colleagues heard about this and told me. I directed that he be given a reserved parking place immediately adjacent to the entrance to Kyle Field. The next home game, Norm drove up to his new spot, again to find it occupied by a university police car with another police car blocking it. He got out of his car and told the officers he'd been promised that parking place. And the officers replied, "It is your place, Dr. Borlaug. We're here to make sure nobody takes it." Two things are clear. Norm was a great sports fan, and he had a special kind of humility. His grandchildren say that for a long time, they mainly knew him as the kindly man who was occasionally around to watch baseball. They had no idea he was famous. He coached Little League Mexico. One player was New Mexico's governor, Bill Richardson, and another is one of A&M's most outstanding benefactors, Pablo Marvin. One of his greatest thrills late in life was to throw out the first ball for the Boston Red Sox in June 2004. Dr. Borlaug never asked for or expected anything special to be done for him, quite the opposite. He refused help with his characteristically heavy briefcase or his luggage. Once on a trip to study the effect of Agent Orange around the Ho Chi Minh Trail, he took the worst seat in the van and refused to give it up. Norm had simple tastes. He ate the simplest of food and not much at that. He merely picked at fancy dishes and often just asked for a chicken sandwich. Norm intensely disliked grandiosity and effusive compliments, but he fully understood the power of his reputation. He regarded himself as an instrument, which he used tirelessly for the benefit of others. He said wrestling made him tough. He was a fierce advocate for science and innovation. He was firm in his beliefs and vigorous in expressing them. His was not the reticent kind of humility. I had the privilege of knowing Dr. Borlaug as teacher, scientist, and warrior in combating hunger. First, his role as teacher. Norm urged that talent be sought in unexpected places, that bookkeepers, technicians, farmers, and the like should become researchers. He would say that new ideas are needed, and people from different backgrounds would bring new perspectives. Several decades ago, a young researcher named Ansef Harabi of Tunisia was plowing one night when out on the road a car stopped. A man came out on the field, stopped Harabi's tractor, and asked why he was plowing so late. Harabi explained that he needed to get his wheat experiment in the ground as soon as possible after the first rain. After a brief chat, Norman Borlaug asked Harabi to come to the United States for graduate school. He did. And Dr. Harabi has now spent a lifetime in cereals research for Northern Africa. This was Norm Borlaug the Builder, who at every opportunity encouraged learning and built armies of agricultural workers. Speaking recently with agricultural teams returning from Iraq, Norm's immediate advice was to get young researchers into training programs and graduate schools. Working with Norm, Chris Dowswell, and the Department of Agriculture framed the Borlaug Agricultural Science and Technology Scholars Program, later incorporated into the 2006 Farm Bill. And this was Norm's passion late in life. He wanted training not only for young scientists, but for retooling and support of developing country professionals at mid-career, and for senior managers and policymakers who needed time for reflection and counsel. Norm truly valued his time on this campus and with our students. He spoke as firmly as any professor about his obligation to be on campus for the fall term, teaching, meeting, and advising students. He was very serious about his role as a teacher here, showed up on campus in July, ready to meet students in August. He arrived at his office at the Soil and Crop Science Department at 5 o'clock every morning. He was often teamed with another professor whose principal job it was to help him wind down his lessons so the kids could get to their next class. Dr. Borlaug urged students to challenge the order of things, to be bold, and not to let bureaucracy defeat them. When students would ask how they should get started in international development, he would often advise them to join the Peace Corps. Frequently, his last admonition in a lecture was to reach for the stars and get a little of that stardust, and then pursue your dreams against all odds. This was another part of his teaching lesson: persist against opposition. Indeed, Norm's avid engagement of bureaucratic opposition is legendary. Second, as scientists, Norm often said that the fear of change is the greatest obstacle to progress. He came down on the side of innovation and is known for being bold and quick to act. Industry leaders were always fond of Norm because he was such a strong advocate for innovation and technological change. Norm's most potent view of science was that man's most advanced knowledge and technology should be used in the battle against hunger and poverty. He was greatly troubled by the unwillingness of nations to employ the best technologies in food production. In his view, there was no technology too developed, too advanced for developing nations. Even fellow scientists and research administrators did not escape his admonition when they moved slowly on research to develop high-protein maize and rust-resistant wheat. "There's a Nobel Prize waiting," he said, "for the person who finds the rust resistance gene in rice and moves it to the wheat plant." Once he was told by his project leader in the Mexican Wheat Improvement Program, "Norm, this scheme of yours has been considered twice, at your insistence, and voted down twice. Why can't you accept that?" Norm countered, "I have a couple of more things to say. You're laying down policy that is wrong, and I can't go along with it. As of now, I resign. You'll have it in writing first thing in the morning." Cooler heads prevailed, and Norm's program continued, eventually shattering myths regarding the adaptability of the wheat plant. Norm needed guile and daring, along with science, to start the green revolution in Asia. His tests of new seeds in Pakistan were hidden in the fields because the tests had not yet been approved. The tests would provide the necessary proof that the short wheat would perform if he could get the seeds in there in sufficient quantity. He somehow mistook his permission for 2 sacks of seed for 2 truckloads of seed. A war was raging when he arrived with the new seed in Pakistan, and the fields were planted in the presence of gunfire. Remarkably, agricultural workers in Iraq and Afghanistan still find farmers growing what they call the Mex-Pak variety of wheat, the original wheat introduced by Norm. Third, as a warrior against hunger. In my current job, I have the opportunity to understand how important Norm's work was and is for the security of this nation, and indeed of all nations. The award of the Nobel Peace Prize to Dr. Borlaug was extraordinarily meaningful. It affirmed a truth that the alleviation of hunger and poverty is essential to peace. Norm said in many different ways that peace cannot be built when hunger persists. Norm planted his fields in Pakistan in the midst of violent conflict. He made the point that development assistance cannot wait for peace. It is a part of making peace, a lesson as meaningful and relevant today as decades ago. Norm would say that even in a war zone, people struggle to feed their families and should be assisted by persons of goodwill. Norm's example and his words live on in those he taught and mentored. An outstanding student leader in the College of Agriculture, Blaise Curie, graduated in May 2008 and immediately joined Team Borlaug in Iraq. He wrote in his journal on August 1st, 2008, about a meeting with local Iraqis and an important provincial leader. The last slide in the presentation had Dr. Borlaug's famous words, "If you desire peace, cultivate justice, but at the same time, cultivate the wheat, the fields to produce more bread. Otherwise, there will be no peace." After a long silence, the Iraqi provincial leader, tears in his eyes, finally spoke. "This wonderful idea that we can have peace through helping our farmers is new to us. I cannot express how thankful I am for this team from America coming to our province of Najaf. You did not have to come, but you left the peace and comfort of your own university to come and help us make agriculture better in Iraq." Blaise Curie wrote in his journal, "I believe that a man becomes a legend and his life becomes a legacy at the very moment his message transcends all barriers of human understanding. And the moment that individuals recognize that understanding and they mutually agree to put it into action, the world comes to a short pause. Everything is still, and everyone knows that something monumental is about to occur in the name of a legend." Dr. Norman Borlaug, the man and the legend, inspired thousands to feed the world and inspired millions to believe it is possible. Our most important observance of Norm's passing is to persist in that work and in that belief. Norm closed his commencement address here at A&M in 2003 with these words, "We Americans should count our blessings. I urge you not to become arrogant and close your eyes and hearts to the less fortunate, especially the nearly 1 billion people who begin and end each day hungry. By helping the less fortunate, you serve God as well as your country. Remember, compassion is the greatest of all human virtues. Remember, compassion is the greatest of all human virtues." There is no more fitting epitaph for Dr. Norman Borlaug.
Would you stand up for prayers? After each petition, I'll say, "God of mercy," and you're all invited to say, "Hear our prayer." And then we'll we'll go ahead with the Lord's Prayer. Some of us commit trespasses, some of us have debts, that's okay. We'll just all say it together. Almighty God, give faith and persistence to all who long for a better future, that we may believe in a world without hunger and one day soon see it with our own eyes. God of mercy, hear our prayer. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, give wisdom and compassion to all leaders in government, science, and every field, that they may be mindful of the poor and generous in training up young leaders for future generations. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, spark the imaginations of all who seek answers to urgent global questions, that they may be open to surprises and discover solutions in unexpected places. God of mercy. Almighty God, rekindle the spirits of all who are weary from illness or age, that they may rise up as on eagle's wings and give their gifts to the needs of the world. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, sustain the hopes of those who have less than enough, that they may know their efforts are not in vain and that they are not forgotten. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, give humility and conscience to all who have more than enough, that they may listen to poor people and deny neither their needs nor their dignity. God of mercy, hear our prayer. We commend to the God of love our brother Norman. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face shine on him and be gracious to him. The Lord look upon him with favor and give him peace. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, give courage and comfort to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrows on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the fruitful earth. Bless all those who work in the fields, grant them good crops, and give all people a share in your abundance. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. You can be seated. A couple of years ago, Dr. Borlaug was very sick, and some people began to think about this service. So I thought we ought to ask Dr. Borlaug what he wanted in his memorial service. So I flew down to Dallas and met with him and his daughter, Jeannie, and his granddaughter, Julie, around his kitchen table. I told him what I was there for. Just asked him what he wanted at his memorial service. And he said, right away he said, you should look at the end of my Nobel lecture, because I quoted from the Bible there. That would be good to use. And that was the passage from Isaiah that we read. And then he made big declarations. It was almost inappropriate at the kitchen table, but I was writing them down. And as I look back over my notes, what's clear is that he was giving us our assignment. Dr. Borlaug would often give people assignments. You know, he'd tell them, read this, do this. And this is what he said around his kitchen table. My desire is to see that programs are carried forward to overcome hunger, poverty, and disease. Adequate food, public health, and education contribute to stability. I believe in the proper use of science to improve the use of land. That's our assignment. I want to say that right now, in these months, the United States government is leading, mobilizing a new global effort to strengthen agriculture and food security in poor countries, an effort that will entail something like $20 billion in additional funding from the world's richer countries over the next 3 years. We have two secretaries of government with us today. And I want to thank them for their leadership on this. What is happening right now, what the world is doing right now to address the recent surge in world hunger is the best possible memorial to Dr. Borlaug. They're carrying out their part of the assignment. Dr. Borlaug didn't go to church very often, so I asked him, do you want a Christian service? Do you want Jesus in the service? He said, oh, sure. I asked him what songs he'd like us to sing. That gave him pause. But then he said, well, the Iowa Corn Song. We weren't sure that it was that was dignified enough, but he was adamant that he wanted the Iowa Corn Song sung. He sang that every school day as a boy in his school in Iowa. Every morning he sang the Iowa Corn Song, and he loved the song, and he wanted us to sing it. And he also mentioned Rock of Ages, which I loved. I don't think I ever met a person who was more committed to doing good. He was good to his family, good to the people around him. He was indefatigable in his work. Dr. Swaminathan mentioned his last words 2 days before his death. He was unsettled, and his daughter asked him what was wrong. He said, "I've got a problem." She wanted to help him, so she said, "Well, what's your problem?" He said, "Africa." This is 2 days before his death. But Norman Borlaug now rests from his labors. In the last years of his life, in the last days of his life, he was surrounded by his loving family. That surely was a good time for him. And he can rest in the grace of God. He had faults and frailties, as all of us do, but he can rest in the grace of God. And he can rest in faith, because he believed that there is a force in the world that is much bigger than us, and he saw very clearly that we live at a time when we can reduce, dramatically reduce, hunger, poverty, and disease. There are things that all of us can do to make that happen, and that is our assignment.
What an amazing tribute to my grandfather to have so many of you here today who've traveled from all over the world to honor his memory. On behalf of the entire Borlaug family, we thank you for being here to show your love of him and your support for his work. As his family, we've always been so proud of his passion, his spirit, and his endurance in pursuing such a focused and selfless life. Many of you know him from an agricultural, professional, or humanitarian perspective. We would like to share with you for just a minute our perspective of our two daddy, father, grandfather, and great-grandfather. Growing up, the grandchildren enjoyed our glimpses of two daddy as he arrived in Dallas for a few days here and there. He loved hearing about how we were doing in school and in sports, the fundamental cornerstones from his early life to which he attributed strength and success. It may be hard for many to imagine him seated in a big wingback chair with grandchildren precariously perched above him on the chair back doing his hair. He would sit patiently as we brushed, combed, and styled him. No doubt he was reading diligently and completely tuned out to the fact that we were playing beauty parlor. But he was there as our somewhat willing participant. Two Daddy also thought of us while on his many travels. We all would receive postcards periodically from all parts of the globe, and on his visits home, we would often be surprised with a doll or a trinket. To us, these postcard collections and extensive doll collections were constant reminders of Two Daddy and his travels, as well as reminders of the many cultures and people from the far corners of the world whose lives he touched. In the past few weeks, one memory in particular has continued to come back to me. At my college graduation, as our family was all in the car, going from one event to another, Two Daddy was in the front seat, swinging on a star, the Frank Sinatra version, came on. Two Daddy began tapping his foot, nodding his head, and and finally broke into song, singing aloud to every word. At the time, I was speechless, having never heard him sing, much less that passionately and spontaneously. This memory has always remained vivid in my mind because he sang the lyrics as if he'd written them himself, and the smile on his face and the animated delivery showed that he truly aspired to swing on a star and carry moonbeams home in a jar. While reading several of the wonderful articles written in the past few weeks, I stopped in my tracks as I read a favorite quote of his: "Reach for the stars. Although you will never touch them, if you reach hard enough, you will find that you get a little stardust on you in the process." For me today, Two Daddy was like that star. Something to aspire to, reach for, admire. I hope that I've gotten a little stardust on me just from being close to him. Over the years, as Two Daddy traveled and spent so much time away from his family, we often heard many grateful individuals say, "Thank you for sharing him with the rest of the world." We would now like to say that it is we who are grateful for having had the chance to know the world through him. In some small way, we feel that we have aided in his passion and that we have somewhat connected to the world he has touched. We are happy that we have shared him, but also, like so many around the world, are sad that he is gone, yet so thankful for so many years with Two Daddy. In honor of a place dear to his heart, Ciudad Obregón, Sonora, I'll end with one of his favorite sayings: "Vaya con Dios, Two Daddy."
After the service, everybody is invited to the exhibit hall for a reception, and then this afternoon at 3 o'clock to the Borlaug Symposium. Please rise for the benediction. Please then remain standing while the cadets sing the recessional and while the family departs. Almighty God, bless us all. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.